Good morning, class. I'm Mr. David Ayoro, a teacher of chemistry. We were discussing, acid bases and salts. And in our previous lesson, we discussed the definition of acid. We also discussed the definition of bases. We discussed the strength of the acids. We also discussed the strength of the bases. We discussed the comparison of the acids and bases using the pH values and also electrical conductivity. Today, we want to discuss the basicity of the acid, the solvent effect of the acid and basic properties. Then we finalize with the oxides and hydroxides. So let us start with the basicity of acid. What is basicity of acid? This is the number of replaceable hydrogen atoms per acidic molecule. The number of replaceable hydrogen atoms per acidic molecule. Also, we can say that the number of replaceable protons per acidic molecule. So we have got monobasic acids, dibasic acids, and tribasic acids. So monobasic acids. Monobasic acids are the simple acids which have got one replaceable hydrogen atoms per acidic molecule. We have got hydrochloric acid, we have got nitric 5 acid as examples. So they will only replace one hydrogen. If they react with a metal, only one hydrogen will be replaced from the acidic conjugate. So dibasic acids, these are acids which have got two replaceable hydrogen atoms per acidic molecule. So examples are sulfuric 6 acid and carbonic acid. So the two hydrogen atoms will be replaced whenever it reacts with any substance, maybe a metal, thereby producing hydrogen gas. And the sulfate, which is a conjugate of the acid, will react with the metal to produce salt. Tribasic acids, these are acids which have got three replaceable hydrogen atoms per acidic molecule. Like example is phosphoric acid. So let us look at the solvent effect on the acidic and basic properties. So we find that acid will not have any acid will not have the hydrogen ions unless it is dissolved in water. So you find that hydrogen chloride gas has got no any acidic property when it is dry. That is to say, if it is not dissolved in water. Why? Because there will be no hydrogen, there will be no water to ionize the hydrogen into its ions. While the hydrogen chloride, if dissolved in water, will have the acidic properties. That is to say, it will dissolve in water to form hydrochloric acid. This hydrochloric acid aqua in aqua solution will have hydrogen ion, which will ionize to produce hydrogen ion, which will have the effect on blue litmus paper. It will also have the effect on sodium carbonate. It will also conduct electricity. While dry one will not have any effect on litmus paper. So look at the equation. Explain why dry hydrogen chloride gas has got no effect on litmus paper, but it changes moist litmus paper red. The reason is that dry hydrogen chloride gas is a molecule, it's in molecular form. So it does not have any ions, mobile ions, hydrogen ions, which will make it have the acidic property. But in water, it will form hydrochloric acid, which will eventually have the hydrogen ions. And hydrogen ions are the ions which will make the compound have the acidic property. So the presence of hydrogen ions will change blue litmus paper red. While in dry, the dry hydrogen chloride is in molecular form, it lacks mobile hydrogen ion, which will make it have the acidic property. Also, Also, moist hydrogen cloud gas will react with sodium carbonate to produce bubbles of carbon dioxide, while dry hydrogen cloud gas has got no effect on sodium carbonate. The reason is that hydrogen chloride, when dissolved in water, produces hydrogen ions, which will react with the carbonate, produce carbon dioxide, which will be seen as bubbles of colorless gas. Moist hydrogen chloride gas will also conduct electricity, thereby making hydrogen gas produced at the cathode, while chlorine gas produced at the anode. While dry hydrogen chloride gas does not conduct electricity. The reason is that the dry hydrogen chloride gas is in molecular form. It does not have the ions which will move into the electrons, thereby conducting electricity. So dry hydrogen chloride gas has got no effect on sodium carbonate. Also, it does not conduct electricity because there will be no ions which will make it have the acidic property. The same to a solution of ammonia gas. Ammonia gas in methyl benzene has got no effect on litmus paper, while a solution of ammonia gas in water has. Explained. This is because ammonia gas, being a molecular compound, will dissolve in water. Because water is polar, ammonia gas dissolves in it to produce ammonium hydroxide, and the presence of hydroxide ion is the one which will make litmus paper change from red to blue. While in methyl benzene is an organic compound, non-polar, ammonia gas will not dissolve in it. Ammonia gas will dissolve in it, but does not ionize. So the lack of ionization of ammonia gas in methyl benzene makes it lack the basic property. So it will not change litmus paper to blue. That is to say, ammonia gas in methyl benzene just is a molecular compound which does not have any basic property. It does not have any hydroxide ion. Let us look at the oxides and hydroxides. You find that an oxide is a binary compound of oxygen and another. We have got four oxides. We have got basic oxide. These are metallic oxides. Magnesium oxide, sodium oxide, calcium oxide. Those are metallic oxides. We have got also neutral oxides. These are oxides of pure non-metals. They don't have any acidic or basic property. Examples are water, carbon 2 oxide, nitrogen 1 oxide, and nitrogen 2 oxide. These are neutral oxide. We have got acidic oxide also. The oxides of non-metals, carbon 4 oxide, sulfur 4 oxide, nitrogen 4 oxide, phosphorus pentoxide, and sulfur 6 oxide. They dissolve in water to produce acidic solution. Hence, we call them acidic oxide. We have got also amphotericic oxides. These are oxides of metals which have got both acidic and basic properties. So we have got zinc oxide, we have got aluminium oxide, and we have got lead 2 oxide. So a question can be framed like this one. What is amphotericic oxide? So just say that these are oxides of metals which have got both acidic and basic properties. Name one oxide which is amphoteric. So you name any zinc, aluminium, or lead. So see, write two chemical equations to show that the named oxide in B above is amphoteric. This one will force you to write the equation for the reaction between that oxide with any acid and with strong alkalis. Strong alkalis are sodium hydroxide or potassium hydroxide. So with sodium, so if you write zinc oxide, if you name zinc oxide as the amphoteric in B, so zinc oxide plus nitric acid will give you zinc nitrate plus water. So in this case, zinc oxide is behaving like a base because it reacts with acid, produce salt and water. Also, you can write zinc oxide plus sodium hydroxide, giving you sodium zincate. A zincate ion has a valency of 2. Sodium valency of 1 and how they extend their valency. So the formula for sodium zincate is like this, plus water. In this case, sodium hydroxide being a base, it means that zinc oxide is acid. So the two equations show that zinc oxide is amphoteric. If you choose lead, you will react lead 2 oxide with acid, producing lead nitrate plus water. Also, lead 2 oxide plus sodium hydroxide giving you sodium plumbate plus water. So plumbate ion, a valence of 2. So the exchange is sodium to form sodium plumbate plus water. In this case, zinc lead 2 oxide is behaving like acid. If you choose aluminum oxide plus sodium hydroxide, it will form what we call sodium aluminate plus water. Sodium aluminate ion has a valence of 1. Hence the formula is this one, because sodium has a valence of 1. So the sodium aluminate is of this nature. So if you choose aluminium oxide as aluminium oxide, so you write aluminium oxide with nitrogen fiber C to produce aluminium nitrate plus water, and you balance, then aluminium oxide plus sodium hydroxide are giving aluminium sodium aluminate plus water. Also, the hydroxides are amphoteric. So if you choose zinc hydroxide, so it will react with nitrogen fiber C to produce zinc nitrate plus water. In this case, zinc hydroxide is being like a base. Zinc hydroxide can also react with sodium hydroxide to produce sodium tetrahydroxyl zinc 2 ion. Tetrahydroxyl zinc 2 ion is of this formula. So as a valency 2. So how they exchange their valency? So this one, it means that sodium hydroxide is a base and zinc hydroxide is a C. Ionic equation for the same. Sodium hydroxide can react with the two, after cancelling the specific ion, will remain with sodium hydroxide plus hydroxide ion, giving you tetrahydroxyl zinc 2 ion. If you choose aluminum oxide and hydroxide as an example of a hydroxide, so aluminum hydroxide plus sodium hydroxide will give you sodium aluminate, so it will give you sodium tetrahydroxyl aluminum ion as an example of acidic oxide, because this one is a basic oxide. So in this case, you must be well acquainted with the knowledge of reaction between this oxide with acids and the oxide with bases, the hydroxide with acids and the hydroxide with bases, for you to qualify for the 2 marks here. Otherwise, this topic is a very important topic, and I want you to continue revising it properly as we wait for our cases. Thank you.